So first we learn to use the bow arm, and that's what they talk about this part here, right? Then we use what I call the second bow arm, or actually for me it's more of my first bow arm, because that's what does most of the work. See that? Down bow, up bow, down bow, up bow. But first we use the arm. So you start using the arm and you get to a certain speed, and the arm is a lot of work to move that arm, right? Really, really hard. So so it's the natural progression is to try to get to the end. There's a lot of great analogies for that. There's the scarf. You know, if you have a scarf and you're whipping it back and forth, that's what your arm should look like. See that?
Yep.
Okay. And there's the whip. So your right arm is supposed to be a whip, which means that the whole thing flings all the way to this knuckle. Hmm. This knuckle can't whip because it's got to be curled up under the bow. So it's like that. See that? That's the end of the whip. That's another analogy. And they're all really good. I think I talked about before about bow push-ups.
Yep.
And how bow push-ups turn into the bowing with your hand. See that? So you start off as push-ups, and when you get the hang of it, you can kind of, you can hold your bow up here like this, and you can try to do bow push-ups, so let's start with bow push-ups. So let's do a few of those first. Looking good there, ladies. Very good. Okay. You getting those, Steven? Now look what I'm doing here. You're not getting your thumb involved. So I'm clutching the whole thing up like that. See that? Yeah. And then I'm putting her back down like that, all the way so that my thumb is now straight. Yeah. And it's tough, and I can see that this is one of the things holding you back. Once you get this suppleness with your fingers and your thumb, it's going to open up that hand bowing for you. Okay?
This is not it, right?
Not quite, no. See, what you got going on, you got your thumb up underneath like this, and you're trying to do it kind of like that. Let's do it like this, with your hand right above the bow, dangling down, everything dangling. There you go. Yes. And you're going to clutch it up, your thumb included. Yes. And then back down. Yeah. That's a bow push-up. You feeling that?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's do a few of those. How are you guys doing with the bow push-ups? Is it working okay? That looks good, Julie. Very good. Let's see yours, Elaine. I can't really see you. Yep, that's good. Really good. Is your thumb curling too? That's something to work on. See how my thumb curls? Pokes it up into the palm there. Yeah, that's good. Good thumb. How you getting along, Steven? It's looking good. You got the right idea now, anyway. You'll have to practice it, but that's what you do. So it's not like this, right? This exercise. This exercise is this to that. Yeah, that's good. Oh, that's good. You got long fingers too. You should be able to get a good dotted quarter note there out of your hand. Because that's what I go for. I go for being able to get a full dotted quarter note before I have to use my arm. See that? Yeah, that's what you want. And that's why these fingers often come off of the bow. Because I'm looking for that big stretch. If I kept it on like you're supposed to, I wouldn't be able to get that dot on the dotted quarter note. So I'm fully extended. Now that you've done a few bow push-ups, you can put your fingers on the bow at the stick. Be careful not to touch the hair. And then so that it's kind of freely kind of rolling there. And then you're going to try to do some bow push-ups sideways. Yeah, that's it. And then clutch it up. That's good. Yeah, that's good. That's good. Yeah. How you doing, Elaine? Give it a try. That's good. Yeah. Clutch it up. Yeah, that's good. Oh, that's pretty good. It's pretty good. Now you're using a lot of your wrist as well. And the reason that is because the normal progression with being able to bow with just your hand is that most people can do the down bow pretty easy. But then when it goes to do the up bow, people find it difficult to do the opposite motion. And then you can fool yourself by just using your hand or your arm. on the up bow. See that? So you want to make sure you do the down bow is looking really good, but the up bow, by the time I'm finished my up bow, I'm, see that? I'm fully kind of crimpled up with my knuckles. Yeah, that looks good. And then you're down. Yeah, and then you're up. Oh, it's looking better. Okay, now put the bow on here again. Oh my God. Okay, put the bow on here again, and we'll do a little bit more of that. Yeah, that's better, Elaine. You gotta shoot that hand up, shoot them knuckles up. Looking good, Julie, very good. Okay, you too, Steven, pretty good. Your up bow needs work too, but those long fingers are gonna help you. Okay?
Okay.
Now, so that's the hand bowing. That's what it feels like. And that's 90% of what I do is that hand bowing. See that? And that's what it feels like. Now, you might notice that it's less work because it's just a small muscle group. So you can kind of do that. It's like twiddling your fingers. You can do that all day, right? And you can do it very fast as well. And that's how you get the really fast tempos with a lot, with not very much work. So anyway, so there you go. So that's how we're going to improve the speed. And these, Julie and Elaine, I think would definitely appreciate working on that as well. There's really nobody that I know that thinks that they're finished working on, you know, being smooth and fast. So we'll definitely do that.
Okay.
All right. And how are you guys doing? Julie and Elaine, you doing good? How did you guys get along with orchestra rehearsal last night?
I didn't make the rehearsal last night because I was flat on my back. I had my COVID booster shot on Tuesday and it knocked me out for like 36 hours. And it's the first time it's happened. And then this morning it was like, I'm back to normal.
Wow.
So I've got to wait till the video goes up so that I can work on that stuff from last night.
Earlier.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll work on it then. Because okay. we learned a new tune called The Morning Thrush.
Yes, I got the music that you'd sent out. So
Yeah, and it's really nice. Everybody liked it. There was controversy about the tune that comes after Jenny's Welcome to Charlie, because it's a piper called Seamus Ennis. It's his version of the tune, and it's very different than the usual Jenny's Welcome to Charlie. Like it's the structure is there, but it's got all these crazy notes, and it's kind of a very famous version of the tune. And he played the two tunes together, so I thought it'd be nice to do a Seamus Ennis set. But a couple of people were like, I don't like that version. Ross thought it was. He got all mad because he thought that the Irish had stolen it from the Scot, because it's a Scottish tune. And I was like, well, yes, they did. They steal lots of our music, and we steal theirs too. And actually, most of the big Illan pipe tunes that are the big flashy show tunes for the Illan pipes are Scottish tunes, like Colonel Fraser and Lord Gordon's, and originally Scottish tunes. You know, I don't know why. One thing is that Scotland invented the reel. There were no reels in Ireland before Scottish people started going over there. So that could be why, because all those tunes are reels, you know. But anyway, so we did. It was, you missed a lot. There was drama. It was intrigue. It was insane. Now, how about you, Elaine? How did you get along?
I was tired at the end of it. It was a workout.
It was. It was a lot of playing.
Yeah.
But you were hanging in there good. I was watching your fingers. You were doing really good.
Yeah, on some of them. I'm still having trouble with the bridge one.
Craig Alecky.
Yeah, Craig Alecky. Yeah, it's tough. So
I thought that's why I got it started early, because I figured we're going to be working on this tune every week until we perform it. You know what I mean? Like, because it's a challenge, and it'll be for a lot of people the first big stress play that they actually play. You know.
Yeah.
With lots of stuff going on.
Yeah. So. Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah. So don't worry. We're going to keep working on it. Okay, great. Well, let's get started. So what do we do? We'll start with G major. I think it'd be a good place to start. I've been doing B a lot lately, but now I miss G. So we'll get started with that. And we'll do the scale. We'll do the arpeggio. We'll do some double stops. And with the double stops, we're going to do hand, arm, arm. We're going to try really hard to do that, okay? So first of all, we'll work up the scale. Let me get my tuner up so I keep us all honest. Okay. Oh, tuner froze. I don't know why it does that. Very annoying. Okay. I just got to make sure my fiddle's in tune because although the strings have settled in, there's still a little bit. Yeah, it's flat. Feeling about G? Did that go okay? Okay, good. Let's pick up the tempo a little bit, do it again. Same setup, scale followed by arpeggio. It's gonna be this fast. One, two, three, go! Success. Okay, then let's do it again right away. Exactly the same, except better. One, two, three, go. Okay. You know what happened, Stephen?
I missed a note somewhere and then messed up the timing.
That right? Well, we'll do it again right away. You can always use the work. Okay, I'm still trying to roll a perfect game here, so I don't mind doing it again. 1, 2, 3, go! Perfect game for me. Close. There was two notes that had a sliver of red. One was the B on the A string, and it was only for a split second. And then the G on the D string, again, a tiny sliver for a split second. So that was my report. How did you guys do? You do pretty good?
Good. Dan, you're using that, the, what was that?
Tunable.
Tunable. Now, what I noticed is it on your computer or is it on your app?
It's an app on my computer and on my phone. I have it both on my computer and on my phone.
And do you have a Windows-based app or is it a Mac-based?
I have a Mac.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. Are you a Windows?
It's available on Windows. The two.
No.
No, I think it's only available on Mac probably, and then on Android and iOS.
What do you have?
I have it on a.
I'm sorry.
I have it on an Apple iPad.
Okay.
And I have it on my phone.
Okay.
But it seems to me I had it on my computer prior to that, and that's got a Windows operating.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Well, yeah, it's really good on the computer. I mean, it's fine on the phone as well, certainly. But on the computer, it's great because I can put it down in the very corner of my screen. And so basically, I like using the tuner like when it's sort of only when you're out of tune. So like, for instance, when I first started teaching during the pandemic, I was teaching on my phone, which meant I couldn't use my tunable app. And so I dug out my old tuner from when I was touring with the Irish Dancing Show, which was a Korg CA15, just a basic digital tuner. And when I was on tour, one weird thing about it was that at a certain point during the tuner or tour, it stopped registering when you were in tune, because it had a green light that was supposed to be green and a dial. And so when you were in tune, it was straight up and down the dial and the light was green. And for some reason, that part wouldn't work anymore. So it only lit up out of tune when you were out of tune. And when I was first teaching during the pandemic, I thought it was just the greatest thing, because I just had it there and I would just kind of catch my attention when it kind of lit up. I could see exactly how far somebody was out of tune. So I kind of find that it's better for it to indicate that than it is to be trying to make it green all the time. So that way I have it down in the corner of my screen. And if I see little bits of red or whatever, then I pay attention and I see what's going on. See what I mean?
I use this one.
And I don't know that one, but I mean, there are millions of tuning apps.
It just moves, right?
Yeah.
I'm playing a certain note, it tells me. But it's not like yours where it shows how far you are away.
I find that useful. And I've tried a bunch of different tuning apps, and I keep coming back to this one because it's so simple, but also very precise.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Now let's do some double stops. First of all, we'll just practice them, then we're gonna hand bow them. Okay, so first of all, just plain old double stops, and we'll do two bows per set of double stops. So down and up, and then move to the next one. Okay. 1, 2, 3, go.
Thank you.
again. Looked like it was a little shaky here and there. Let's do it again right away. Oh, hello, Zelia. How you doing? Huh? I don't know. Where'd you find it? Coffee table. Check in your room. I'm going to put it away.
I'm sorry, I can't have
it. Okay. I don't know. Check it. Check some of the places in the kitchen and the cupboards and the drawers and stuff. Sylvia made a load of slime for her friend. She makes slime using school glue and contact lens solution and shaving cream and food coloring. And she made a load of slime for her friend Ariel at school, who told her that her dad left the house and that they don't have a dad in their house. And she was quite sad about it. And so Sylvia made her some slime to cheer her up. Anyway, it's very nice of her that you forgot it. Okay, let's do it again. Nice and gentle. That's the name of the game with double stops, is nice and gentle with the bow. Speed and angle. Ready, go. Let's try it. Hand, 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 arm, arm. For each set of double stops, I'll demonstrate it first so you can look. Got the idea? Let's do it. One, two, three, go. Check in. How are we getting along? How does it feel? Feel okay? Weird? Anybody have any feedback?
I find the short ones are really hard to get the right angle because I'm like, you know, my hands moving the bow a little differently. When you do the long ones, it seems to be easier to keep it on the two strings.
Yes. Now, my advice to that is gentle up on the grip of your bow, so that your fingers aren't kind of pushing it around. All right.
Yeah, I think I'm trying to grab it too hard. Maybe I feel myself I feel myself grabbing the bow.
Yeah. So lighten up on that grip as much as you feel like you have to tighten up. Use that same amount to loosen off and to just, you know, people often say that when they're working on the jig rhythm, for instance, you know, the dippity, dippity, dippity. They feel like they start to get the hang of it, they say they feel like the bow is going to fly out of their hand. Okay. And that means they're getting it right. That's when it's doing right, because you're trying to throw the bow back and forth with your hand. See that? So you need a very, very light grip to allow that to happen. So loosen up that grip. The bow hold is supposed to be such that the bow is loose in your fingertips. See that? So keep that in mind and see if it helps. How about you, Elaine? How did you get along?
Yeah, it's a similar type of thing. On the long bows, it's relatively easy to get the both, but with the other, it's I'm sort of all over the place.
Okay, yeah. So okay, you're gonna loosen up your grip too. I think that's you gotta do the same thing. How about you, Steven?
Yeah, I think it's the same, and I find that, you know, doing it without the bow, it's nice. You know, it's easy to move my hand. The moment the bow comes in the hand,
yeah, it opens up. Well, then that tells me that it's your grip as well.
Yeah.
So let's do a little bit of a spider crawl before we do it again. Everybody do a little spider crawl. Remind your fingers how little they have to work to hold that bow, especially your thumb. Your thumb is the biggest culprit in this whole tightening up situation, all right? And you'll notice it because when people are doing the spider crawl, they find the hardest thing to do is to be able to move the thumb without the thumb moving the bow. And so that's what you want to concentrate on, nice and light grip. How are you getting along with that, Stephen? Are you able to do it?
I find that it's easier for me to go up.
Well, yeah.
Issues, but my thumb gets paralyzed. I mean, I cannot even bring down my thumb.
I have to bring
my pinky inside the bowl.
That's cheating.
Yeah, that's cheating.
So look, you're going to work on, basically, all you're going to do when you're working on the spider crawl is try to move that thumb a tiny bit. There you go. You got a little bit. Hey, that's good. It's really good. And lighten up. When you feel like you have to clench, lighten instead. Opposite instinct. Okay? Okay, now let's try it again. Hey, oh, that's Elaine, you're like a pro at that now. That spider is just flying up that bow these days. Very good. Okay, so let's do it. One. Don't stop, Steven. I'm going to mute you, but don't stop. You got the right thing going there. It's perfect. It looks perfect. Here we go. One, two, three, go. Okay, great. So that's the way to work on the hand bowing. It's the best way to work on it. And I find that if you're having problems with the actual, you know, down bow and up bow, do some bow push-ups. And if you're having a problem tightening up your grip while you do it, you know, do the spider crawl. Remind your hand of how little it needs to hold that bow, and remind your hand that it can actually be a bow arm. Okay, and it'll get in there. Very, very good. Now, next week, we're gonna up the game. So I want you guys to really work on that this week, and I'm gonna take a look at you all next week individually, see how the hand is moving, see how it's sounding a little bit, and then if it's all going good, we're gonna add fingers. So you start to get the left hand to start to sync up with the same muscle group. That's the key, using the same muscle group, you know, with your left and your right hand. And that's how you can get the speed up and the effortless, okay? All right, very good. Let's get working on our tunes. Now, I dug the depths there last time, and we worked on old stuff. Can you remind me what we did? Because I've taught about a dozen tunes since then. Hard for me to keep track.
We were working on polkas with John Ryan's and the Carry.
Yes, that's great because we can work on the speed, try to get the speed up. So John Ryan's and the Carry. So let's do that. We'll start with the Carry because that's the first one people usually learn. Let me just grab it here. There it is, in all its glory, Carry polka. All right. Yeah, this is a very common tune, good tune to have. I'm teaching a young fellow there before you guys come. His name is Liam, and his mom is a flute player, and his grandfather is a piper, who's from, they're all from Belfast, except that she was born here. And he's just about at the twinkle, twinkle point. So as soon as we get twinkle, twinkle, he's going to be learning the Carry polka. So let's see, how fast should we do it? You think that'll do it? You think we can handle that? Okay, let's give it a try. And we're gonna do it a good few times, people. A one, two, three, go! Thank you. How you doing there, Elaine? Did that work okay?
Pardon me?
Did that work okay?
Yeah. The sound of the volume is too high for me. I got to skip change stuff.
Oh, I see. Yeah. It's
bothering me through the whole thing.
You mean your own violin?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. How's everybody else? How did that go? How about you, Stephen?
I'm good.
Oh, good. That's great. Okay. Shall we up the tempo a little bit? We might as well. You should hear, I don't know if I played you guys what it's supposed to be, what the tempo is supposed to be for a polka. Polkas are very fast. And if you see the dance, you can see it's extreme. They're hopping around, like flying around the room. And it's a bar on player's and a guitar player's nightmare is to play a polka. It's so hard, but it usually goes this tempo. So the bar on is going, it's like relentless, you know. Same with the guitar. There's not many things you can do with the polka except to just kind of just strum away the eighth notes along with you, you know. So it's very, very challenging, but we won't be going that fast.
And when they go at that speed, do they play slurred notes or is it individual notes?
It depends on where you're from. In Kerry, they tend to play two bows per note. And it gives you this wild sounding groove. And they speed up their bow kind of halfway. See that? And it kind of comes from the accordion. The accordion do it. And it's it's cool. But then it's kind of particular to that part of the island. Also, most people would play it single bow. And then there's all kinds of ways to bow it. All kinds of different ways, but you can't go wrong with downy uppy. Always works. Okay? But it's interesting, and if you ever hear that groove, it's a really cool groove that they get when they play polkas with two notes per bow. Okay, let's try her a little faster. So kind of. One, two, three, go! Like you hit your top speed there.
too fast for me.
That last one?
Yeah.
You got some of it in though.
Yeah, yeah. I got parts of it in, but there's a lot of misses, yeah.
A lot of misses. Okay. Now just to get let you know what that was, I'm thinking. It was about 95 on the metronome. Okay. So that's too fast for you. 95 is too fast for you. So you're going to want to practice. Well, we're going to try it once more. Let's try it down around 80. I have a feeling that's going to be the magic practicing tempo where you have a chance to get it right, but it still hangs together as a two. See what I mean?
Yeah. And okay. For me, it's a combination of both. I think one is this is not moving fast enough. But I also find that I get stuck on the fingerboard too for some of the notes.
And well, is it reading, do you think?
I'm sorry?
Is it reading?
No, it's not. I think my fingers are going in there, but it's still, I'll probably still take some practice too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think we'll just bump it up gradually.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
It's also about synchronization. I think my bow. Sometimes it's the bow before the note, and sometimes it's the note before the bow. So
yes, now that is a very common problem for adults is getting out of sync between finger and bow. And what you have to understand about that is that your finger is supposed to move first. If your bow and your finger move at the same time, you get that overlapping sound.
Yeah. Okay.
But if your finger moves first, then you don't. And it doesn't have a matter how fast you're going. You don't. But you got to make sure it's moving first. So one way to do that is to pick a tune that you know really well that you don't have to read and try playing it and stopping your bow completely between each note. Okay? So for instance, if I were to play, they do it with Twinkle Twinkle in the Suzuki method. They do it with Twinkle Twinkle. So... See how that works there? Completely stop your bow. It forces your hand to move first. You have no choice, and it makes it an instinct. See? Now, most people, adults, find it hard to do that. They start off, they do a few notes completely detached, and then they just run it all together to the end, you know? So it's only good if you actually do it. But I've touched on it a tiny bit with some adults who have that. Many adults have that problem, and it seems to help a lot. Okay, just looking at it a little tiny bit. One tune that you might be familiar with is The Happy Farmer. They do that in the Suzuki book, Detaché Bowing. And that's what they call Detaché Bowing. When you completely stop your bow between the notes, it's called Detaché or Detached Bowing. So that the Happy Farmer would be. You see how that works? It works like a charm. Your hand automatically gets ahead of your bow. And a little bit of that, and it'll work for you even going fast, okay?
I'll try that.
Thank you. You make a good point, though. How about everybody else? How'd you do, Julie, at that speed? Was it okay?
Yeah, I was good. It carries the one piece that I have pretty much memorized. So I find that really helps me to go faster. As you were talking earlier with Stephen about you don't have to be looking at the notes. It just seems to flow so much better.
Yes.
So I was okay. I was okay at that speed.
Oh, that's great. Okay. And how about you, Elaine?
Yeah, I was more comfortable at that speed than when we were going slow.
Oh, that's a good sign. Yeah, and that's kind of the way that it progresses. And this is good practice for you because you've been on that project of getting off book and being able to play the tunes a little bit quicker without having to stop and stuff like that. So you telling me that's a very good sign. So it must be going pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's good. That's excellent. Let's do it at 80. Okay, we're going to play it at 80 to give you a sense of your practicing tempo. And it's going to sound like this.
Wow.
One, two, three, go. It all week, all right? Practicing it at 80 so that we can get it up to the 90 or 95. But that's good to hear. Okay, now let's work on the old John Ryans. Ryan, a very common Irish name. And I worked for the Ryans in Newfoundland. When we lived in Newfoundland, they owned a place called Moo Moo's Ice Cream, where they made their own ice cream and sold it in the store. It was also a little grocery store. It was a really neat place to work because it was right in the middle of town, and all the locals came there for their groceries. And the most common thing you would say at that store is people would ask you for bologna, and they'd say, give me a pound of bologna. And you would ask, is it for frying or is it for sandwiches? Because if it's for frying, it's thick, and for sandwiches, it's thin. But I love the place, and it was white with black spots like a cow. Me and Jennifer both worked there until we got fired because Jennifer got accused of stealing a toonie. And it was really, really weird situation. We come in for our paycheck at the end of the summer, and they pull us down in the office and show us this video of Jennifer doing a transaction with a customer and then putting her hand in her back pocket like this and talking to the other person. And the Mrs. Ryan was like, look, see where you took the toonie? See that? So we both had to get interviewed by the cops. It was actually quite stressful. And she ended up getting reprimanded by the cops for wasting their time. Because what happened was they had just recently installed all these video cameras in the place, first time ever. It was 2001. And I guess they just went to town watching every move everybody was making. And we weren't the only ones. Anyway, those are the Ryans in Newfoundland. Okay, this is a great tune, very well-known tune. You got it there, Stephen, or do you need me to send it? Oh, you got it, okay. So let's go slow. I'm sure it's not, it's very, very easy tune, but let's go slow a couple of times before we speed it up. Okay. Just one second. Oh, that's outside. Everybody's muted here? Yes. Okay. Here we go. So. One, two, three, go. Take a little breather. How's all that working? Good? Good, good? All right, well, faster?
No.
No problem, Stephen?
No, there was a problem. I think the second part I still have to practice. The first part, the first two lines were great. I could play it, but the second, there was some 16th notes that I have to still get used to.
Okay, is it bowing?
It is also bowing, yeah.
Okay, so let's see about the bowing in that second part. All of the 16th notes in the second part, except for the ones in the first ending, are going to be an up-up.
Are going to be?
Up-up.
Oh, okay.
A slur, up-low slur. Every one of them. I'm going to make sure here. So. Except for when we get into the second part, that's going to go like this. So that's all going to be single bow. So if you look at where it says number two in the first part, yeah, ending number two, that's all going to be single bowed.
Just the combination of the last three notes or everything?
The whole bar. So down, up, down, up.
Okay.
And that will put you in a good place to play the whole second part with the up-ups for the 16th notes, right up until you get to the first ending, and then you're going to do the same thing. Down, up, down, up.
Okay.
Okay, see if that helps. Let's give that a try for Stephen here. You guys can try that bowing too. See if it works for you too. It should. That's what I'm doing. So down, up, down, up, up, down, up, down, up, up, down, up, down, like that, okay? One, two, three, go. That's the way to do it, and it'll be smoother and faster. Okay, take a short little breather, and then we're going to do the whole thing again, tiny bit quicker, see if anything goes wrong. Could go wrong. Nothing will go wrong. It'll be lovely. All right. I got the rest of the blinds up in my house today. $3,000 worth of blinds from Select Blinds, but our windows are so huge. They were unusual sizes. Like our sliding door is a complete square. It's like the whole thing is a big square. a huge square, over 8 feet wide. So hard to find a blind, you know, go to Home Depot, there was nothing there. So we had to order them and do all the meticulous measuring. But I have to say, there was Canada Select blinds, and we did the measuring, we used the website, they all came perfect size, perfect. Like, and then so easy to put up, really, really easy. So I would definitely do it again, but expensive for sure. The blind for that door is $800, just that one blind. I just can't believe what I'm doing here. But anyway, me and Jennifer used to live in hovels. That's what we've been doing for the last 20 years. You know, we got used to it. We don't know what to do in this place. We're being right careful. I told Jen, I feel like we're living in an Airbnb, you know? Don't touch nothing. Don't break nothing. Anyway, okay, let's do it. So we're going to go this fast. 1, 2, 3, go! Second part will come together for you, okay? Even if we're going fast. Now let's try mashing the two of them together. Carrie first, okay? Yeah, John Ryan's and then Carrie. Where's that Carrie? There it is. Okay, And let's do it two times each. And we're going to try them at 80. So just keep firing at the Germans. Don't worry about a thing. It'll all be fine. Okay. One, two, three, go! So that was the two polkas at 80. All right. Judge for yourself how you got along at 80 and see if you have to kind of go back a couple of notches with the tempo to get it all in for practicing. But that's where we're going to start next week is 80. Okay, that's where we'll start. Hopefully be able to go up from there. Any questions, problems, comments, concerns, complaints? I got reminded of one we did a long time ago called Hector the Hero. Great tune. And it's because Anne-Marie from the Celtic Orchestra posted a video of a Scottish guy when they were over in Edinburgh playing Hector the Hero there on this tour that they did. And it reminded me of that. And I was also talking about my uncle today. Because somebody was asking me about what I think about when I'm performing, when I'm playing. Because it certainly is not bowing or fingering or anything like that at all. And I was, I thought it was a good question because, you know, it's a weird thing, like you kind of battle getting too comfortable with performing. And I noticed it when I was over in England, when I was performing with the Irish Dancing Show, we were doing 95 shows in a 100-day tour. So every night we were doing a show, sometimes twice. And I couldn't believe after about 6 weeks of doing this show every night for a lot of people, usually 1,000 people at a time or maybe more, you know, a couple of thousand or even 500. And I remember doing this show over and over every night. And at one point, I'm standing on the stage playing my fiddle solo. And what's in my mind is, I wonder where the microwave is for so I can nuke my lasagna I got at Marks and Spencer. You know, this is not what you want to be thinking about when you're trying to make something beautiful, you know. And so I had to figure out a way to get there every night. And it's amazing that the audience doesn't do it. Like, you get used to that. You know, you get totally used to that. It doesn't create that adrenaline anymore, you know? So you walk up there and it just feels like a Tuesday afternoon. And so you have to figure out a way to feel it, to get into it. And for me, my uncle, Hector, who was a priest, and very kind of very important in our family, and that was my dad's brother, and his sister, Sylvia, who my little girl has her name, was a nun. They were both mostly in Antigonish most of their lives. And Father Hector was the greatest guy in the world. He was an amazing priest because he was a priest that didn't really care about being a priest, if you know what I mean. He cursed and swore and smoked 3 packs a day. But all he wanted to do was help people in different communities. And that's what he did. That's all he ever did, was just hanging out with people. And I loved him. And he drove an bounty car. It used to be a cop car, and it still had the searchlight on it from when it used to be a cop car. And just for a laugh, sometimes we'd be driving down the street at night and he'd shine this spotlight at people on the sidewalk just to scare them for a laugh. It was great fun. But anyway, so I used to think about him because he had just died when I started going on tour. He had just died. And so I used to get on the stage and try to picture him. And try to picture his face and everything about it while I was playing. And that really worked. That really brought me into the music and not caring about anything else at all, just totally involved in what I was doing and the sound my fiddle was making. And that seemed to do the trick. And then when I got tired of Father Hector, it would be this story that my dad used to tell about two old fellows from McDonald's who went up into the hills to get firewood for the winter. And it was a long trek to get to where the wood was. It was a horse and wagon. And so they get all the way up there, up the side of the hill or whatever, and they're cutting wood. And everybody used double-edged, razor-sharp, double axe, and, you know, with the two on the other side. And so the one fella was sitting down to have his break, and he sat on the stump, and he got the cup of tea and went to drink the cup of tea. And just as the other fellow that was adjacent to him decided to have his break and went like this to put the backside of the double-bitted axe into the stump. And he didn't know that his brother was sitting there. And the axe went through the arm that was holding the cup of tea, cut his arm off. And so then it was to apply a tourniquet and take Angus into Sydney to the hospital on a horse and wagon through the woods. Like, I don't know how long the journey would have been, and that's what they did. And he took him to the hospital, and he lost his arm, but he lived. And so for a long time on the tour, I just pictured that day, and I pictured being Angus and the sounds and the things that you would be noticing when you're waiting to see whether you're going to live or die. And like, for instance, I used to try to focus on the sound of the other fellow, the brother, trying to get the horses hooked up to the wagon to bring them into town, and how agonizing that must have been, you know, to listen. Okay, he's got the bridle on now. Okay, he's got the straps on now, you know. And so anyway, that did it. Every night I would start to get into that story. Next thing you know, I'm just completely involved in the music and in the story as well. But anyway, so Hector the Hero. We should do Hector the Hero. Sorry for the gruesome story. I'll send it to you there, Stephen. Okay. Hector. Here it is, PDF. Oh, the fingering's written in too, isn't that nice? Okay, there you go. I sent it off to you there. Okay. Day-da-day-da-dum-dee. Now, not only is this a beautiful tune, because it really is a beautiful tune, but also it's such good practice in the key of A. Oh my God. There's not much better practice than Hector the Hero. All right. So. You guys know the drill, okay? We'll go nice and slow. I kind of feel like we should run up and down quickly in A major scale first, though, because A is a big change from what we were just playing. Okay, Stephen, we're going to run up and down an A major scale before we start this tune, because it takes a little getting used to. So that starts on the first finger of the G string. Okay, let's give that a go. Ready, go. Give Hector a go here. We don't have to go fast. That's the other nice thing. I thought it would be a nice break after all those fast polkas. Now we start off, we go A to C sharp, eh? Here's the both notes for you. Okay, let's give it a go. Ready, go. Okay, let's start from the top again. Steven, have you ever heard this tune before? No. Oh. What do you think? Nice one, eh?
Some parts of it reminds me of Leaving Lismore.
Yeah, it's very similar. You're right. And it's certainly in the same key, too. Yeah. But this is a very famous tune. J. Scott Skinner wrote it, and people have been playing it, like, especially beginners, for a long, long time. Ladies, you getting it back? Is it coming back? The key is difficult, especially on the low strings. It's hard. I found I was constantly checking in on my C sharp and my low A. Okay, because the low A wants to come up when you play this tune. It really, really wants to. So you gotta call it push me, pull you. Forward with the third, back with the one, knowing it wants to come up. Okay, now, I was putting loads of drippy vibrato in there. Hey, did you hear that? I was trying to channel my father with his wide vibrato, because he had a very wide vibrato. So we worked a little bit. Do you remember when I talked about how to do vibrato? How you, so, well, okay. So you, what you do is, to do vibrato, you gotta relax your finger flat of the note. Let it roll backwards on the round part of your finger. See that? And especially, more than anything, release the finger pressure that's down there. Like ease up on it. And then bring it back in, up into tune. And then you go flat again, and then you bring it back in up to tune. Let me show you how it goes. That's how vibrato works. Vibrato never goes sharp of the note, only flat of the note, ever, for everybody. And so you roll back on your finger and you bring it in, back on your finger and you bring it in. And when they taught us to do it in Suzuki, they had us do this. And it worked really, really well. See that? On all your fingers. Third finger's hard. See that? That's how you do that. And it's a really good way to do it. They would make us do a scale. They gradually up it. So that was four warbles per note. Then they would get us to do six and then eight. And then you're pretty well doing it. You're pretty well doing vibrato. And you'll find that when you do get the hang of it, you'd be doing it all over the place. J. Just don't do it so much that people think you're a violinist, because you wouldn't want that. That's not all. They vibrate through everything, so you won't want to go that far. And that's a good point. In our music, we use very little vibrato. We actually only use a little bit at the end of a long note, and it's kind of a distinguishing characteristic. So, see how that works there? That's a very scotchy way to do it. Whereas the violinist, it would sound like this. You hear that? Is that a familiar sound? That's a violinist trying to play Scottish music there. That's what that sounds like, okay? So it's something to keep in mind, because you only need to do a little, but it's a really nice way to dress up a tune. You know, it's a nice thing to do to put a little wiggle on it there at the end of the note. So let's try it again. And you can make your little attempts at vibrato or anything else you want to try, especially if you got the tune really good. And I love this tune. I can play it all night. Okay, here's your A. And here's your C. Okay. Ready. Rods in my bow, sorry. Driving me nuts. I just got a rehair, so it takes a bunch of rosinings at first. You don't want to load it up. I don't really like to load it up when I first get a rehair, because it dries out in a weird way. Okay. Here we go. Ready, go. Thank you. people feeling good? I love this tune. It's a great tune. Okay, good. So now let's end on a high note. Let's play the stuff we were practicing so much there, Leaving Lismore, and what was the other one? Anybody remind me what the other one was that we were working on besides Leaving Lismore?
Laddie with the Platy.
Ah, that's the one, Laddie with the Platy. Oh, I happen to have it up in Jerry's book right here. I was working on a tune with a lady, and it's a great tune, and it's called Iggy and Squiggy. Beautiful little tune there, Iggy and Squiggy. Anyway, okay, so we're going to do Laddy with the Platy and Leaving Lismore. Let's do Leaving Lismore first because it's in A. And we just practiced A so diligently. I remember how it goes. Leaving Lismore, here it is. Ooh, that's a big one. Okay. You were right, though. Very similar. You're right, Stephen. Very similar. Hector ascends, or sorry, descends, and this one ascends, but it's the same idea. You're very, very right. Anyway, let's do it. Ready, go! Yeah. Feeling good? Great. Let's do Lenny with the Platy real quick, then we'll be done. And it's the first two parts we're doing, right? Yeah. Because Jerry has a bunch of variations here. We should do them sometime. When we feel real good and confident with the Lenny and the Platy, everybody let me know and we'll do the variations, because they're basically an expansion. Like, I'll play it for you. I'll play the whole thing for you because I just happen to have it open here. Sounding, but it's all smoke and mirrors. You can hear it. It's just a little scale, no big deal, but you know, you can impress your friends, that type of thing. So it's like you're doing kind of exercises on that theme, you know, so it's a really good thing to do. So when we get more solid with it, we'll go on, we'll get the variations. For now, let's play the first two parts a couple of times. A one, two, three. Keep working on it, because I'd love to get the variations. So I'll make videos of them and I'll send them out, and people can start familiarizing themselves with the variations, and then we'll just work through them. We'll use it like an exercise. We'll work through all those variations and it'll be really good. All right, I worked you hard tonight. I hope your left arm is okay, or your right arm if that's what bothers you. And we'll see you guys next week, okay? All right, night.